At least 10 people are dead and 25 are injured after a bus rolled in the Hunter Valley town of Greta, north of Sydney, Australia. The accident, which police said appears to involve only a single vehicle, happened late Sunday amid heavy fog. Authorities say the bus was likely carrying wedding guests. The cause of the accident remains unknown, and authorities are still trying to identify all passengers. Ukraine claims troops have captured three villages from Russian forces in its southeast, the first liberated settlements it has reported since launching its counteroffensive. Kyiv's forces posted unverified videos showing soldiers hoisting flags in adjoining villages in the Donetsk region. Ukraine's deputy defense minister says the army also retook another village to the south and advanced between 300 and 1,500 meters into two directions on the southern front. On Friday, Russian President Vladimir Putin said a Ukrainian military push was well underway, but that it had failed to so far breach Russian defensive lines and have taken heavy casualties. President Volodymyr Zelensky confirmed on Saturday the counteroffensive and defensive operations were in fact taking place. Russia and Ukraine released nearly 100 soldiers from each side in the latest round of prisoner swap. 95 Ukrainian soldiers, some of them wounded, were returned to Kyiv. They included members of the National Guard and Border Guards. 94 Russians in Ukrainian captivity were also released following negotiations. The founder of Russia's most powerful mercenary group, Wagner, asserts his group will not sign any contract with the country's defense ministry. This after the agency ordered all so-called volunteer detachments to ink contracts with the ministry by the end of this month in a bid to increase the effectiveness of the Russian army. Though the defense ministry did not mention Wagner in its public statement, Russian media claimed it was an attempt by the defense minister to bring the mercenaries to heel. The Wagner group has repeatedly attacked President Vladimir Putin's top military brass for what it casts as treachery for failing to fight the war in Ukraine properly. Environmental groups warn ecosystems washed away by the destruction of a Ukrainian dam could take decades to recover. More in this report.
Floodwaters last week poured from the Kakhovka Dam after a deliberate explosion triggered on the Russian-occupied side of the Soviet-era structure along the Dnipro River in Ukraine. Both Ukraine and Russia pointed fingers at each other for what U.S. intelligence analysts say likely was an act of Russian sabotage, according to the New York Times. Flooding on both sides of the disputed dam carried residential and industrial waste through large parts of the region. Environmental groups warn the damage could collapse entire ecosystems and alter the landscape of Ukraine for decades.
The consequences to come will be for our children and grandchildren, just as we are the ones now experiencing the consequences of the Chernobyl disaster.
In April 1986, reactor 4 at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant melted down. According to the United Nations Scientific Committee on the Effects of Atomic Radiation, roughly 350,000 people fled the disaster while some suffered cancers from radiation poisoning. The UN added that the Chernobyl disaster altered the environment and food supplies for years. Environmentalists warn Ukraine's history may be repeating itself following wide-scale flooding that is inherently contaminated and wreaking havoc on local ecosystems.
If this area serves as a nesting place for a colony of bird species, it is possible they will rebuild their colony when water recedes within about 7 to 10 years. However, when it comes to ecosystems that have been destroyed, such as the sandy ecosystems that once existed in our unique territory, their recovery may take decades.
But downstream from the Kakhovka Dam, much of the Ukrainian city of Kherson is now completely underwater. Immediate concerns like clean drinking water for the more than 250,000 people living here take priority over longer-term environmental impacts. Experts say the dangers of the dam burst will only grow. The facility is part of the Kakhovka hydroelectric station that not only supplies water to the Russian-annexed Crimean Peninsula, but also to the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant, the largest in Europe. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
U.S. President Joe Biden lauds the extraordinary courage of LGBTQ Americans as he hosts the biggest Pride event in the White House. More in this report.
Pride is the opposite of shame, a point President Joe Biden stressed at this year's celebration of the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community at the White House.
You are loved. You are heard. You are understood. And you belong. And as I made clear, including in my State of the Union address, your president, my entire administration, has your back. We see who you are, made in the image of God, deserving of dignity, respect, and support.
Not all Americans agree or think these conversations should be held in public. Presidential candidate and Florida Governor Ron DeSantis has signed several bills concerning LGBTQ plus rights, including the so-called Don't Say Gay law, which Biden described as hateful. DeSantis says he's protecting conservative values.
But we will, as president, lean in against woke ideology and against the sexualization of children.
Uganda recently passed the so-called Kill the Gays law, prompting some Ugandans to flee for safety. Biden has described that law as wrong and shameful. But it has supporters.
God created man and woman, and actually what I'm saying is for the majority of Ugandans.
White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre told VOA that this trend of using the law to restrict gay rights makes this year's celebration even more important.
And let's not forget what we're seeing across the country from state houses. More than 600 pieces of legislation, anti-LGBTQ plus legislation. A few hundred of those are against transgender youth. And so we have not seen that type of anti-sentiment, anti-against this community in decades.
The faith community has mixed views on gay rights, and at times members of the same religious congregation will have opposing views on the issue. Pope Francis said this year that homosexuality is not a crime, but that any sexual act outside of marriage is a sin. The Catholic Church does not bless same-sex unions. There are some churches that minister specifically to the LGBTQ plus community.
You have to take a look at the overall message of the Bible, which is affirming of the dignity and the humanity of every human being made in the image of God. That is the context, and a God that stands for love, a God that stands for social justice, a God that stands for an end to poverty and economic exploitation of human beings.
The White House declared June as Pride Month in 1999. And this Pride Month across the U.S., from Biden's Washington all the way to DeSantis' home turf of Florida, these Americans are out and proud. Anita Powell, VOA News, Washington.
Novak Djokovic establishes himself as perhaps the greatest men's tennis player of all time after capturing a record 23rd Grand Slam title at the French Open. The 36-year-old Serb defeated Casper Ruud of Norway in the final to snap a tie of 22 slams he shared with career-long rival Rafael Nadal. For his career, Djokovic has amassed 3 French Open crowns, 10 Australian Open titles, 7 at Wimbledon, and 3 at the US Open. Djokovic is the first man to win all 4 majors at least 3 times.
I was a 7-year-old dreaming that I could win Wimbledon and become number one in the world one day. As I said, I'm beyond grateful and blessed to be standing here with so many incredible achievements. But one thing is for sure. I feel that I had the power to create my own destiny. I try to visualize every single thing in my life, not only believe it, but really feel it with every cell in my body. And I just want to send a message out there to every young person. Be in the present moment. Forget about what happened in the past. Future is something that is just going to happen. But if you want a better future, you create it. Take the means in your hands. Believe it. Create it.
There's little sign of Djokovic slowing down. He's now the oldest French Open champion. On Monday, he will reclaim the world number one ranking. Saudi Arabia's energy minister, Prince Abdulaziz bin Salman, says the recent OPEC Plus deal to collectively cut production targets for next year is one of the ways the alliance is working against uncertainties and sentiment. He says currently, The physical market and futures market are saying opposite things. Reason why producers have to remain in a state of readiness. The Prince adds the new deal is supposed to reward those who invest to grow their production capacity.
When it comes to oil, oil demand in China is still growing. So of course we have to capture some of that demand. So as chemical, so of course we have to capture some of that demand. We want to invest in China because we also have an ambitious program on crude to chemicals. It went through quite a comprehensive reform in arranging these agreements. In the final analysis, what this agreement will achieve for all of us is that those who invest, not this year, but the years to come, 24, 25, 25, and moving forward, there will be a recognition for their investment.
Oil prices fell by more than $1 per barrel on Friday to record a second straight weekly decline. A port terminal in Long Beach, California, now on its final push to become the world's first zero-emissions facility with the help of increased automation. Unions, meanwhile, are hoping a multi-million dollar government grant will help ensure the transition will not result in a loss of jobs. Details in this report.
This port in Long Beach, California, has plans to become the world's first zero-emissions facility. It's betting on both electric power and automated equipment to achieve that goal. The terminal recently secured a $30 million grant from the Biden administration to electrify its tractors. But the money comes with conditions. To safeguard jobs, the new equipment must be operated by humans.
We have reduced our emissions by 90% with a goal with our net zero plan by 2030 to be the first truly net zero container terminal in the world.
As part of its green shift, Long Beach Container Terminal, or LBCT, has purchased 60 electric yard tractors, which haul shipping containers from stacks to waiting trains. CEO Anthony Otto.
The maritime industry is a big producer of emissions in this region for the local communities, and LBCT is doing its part to make sure that we've reduced it down to zero, at least for our operation here at LBCT.
Alongside electrification, LBCT is also betting on automation technology for its decade-long redevelopment that combines two aged terminals into one. Otto says the new facility now handles three times more volume and has reduced emissions by 90%. But in the minds of some union leaders, more automation means fewer jobs. And they have found an ally in the White House. LBCT's electric tractor money came from the federal government's 2022 Port Infrastructure Developments Program that funds projects such as improving cargo efficiency and reducing emissions. But there's a catch. These efforts must not include installation of equipment or infrastructure that would result in job loss or a reduction of job quality. Unions hope the $30 million grant will show the value of prioritizing jobs as U.S. employers adopt green technology. At Long Beach, drivers of the new electric tractors will labor alongside more than 100 automated vehicles and 70 driverless container stacking cranes, making it America's most automated ports terminal. Otto declined to say how many workers have lost jobs in the terminal yard, citing ongoing West Coast ports labor contract talks. He says that the terminal's commitment to the union is that while there was some erosion of typical longshore jobs, there would be creation of new jobs.
On to the NBA Finals, the Denver Nuggets can claim their first ever NBA championship with a win in tomorrow's Game 5. But the Miami Heat are not going down without a fight. Our North America Bureau correspondent Steve Angeles has more.
With a 108-95 victory on Friday night, the Denver Nuggets are now one win away from the franchise's first NBA championship. They addressed the media on Sunday, the eve of their potential closeout game.
I think, this team is different than the other teams we faced. I think they're relentless. Like, they're going to come in full force. We ended up actually blowing Phoenix out in Phoenix, you know what I mean? But we know tomorrow's not going to be like that. But one thing about this team is we just have a game-by-game mentality. So we're viewing it as we're down 3-1. We're not up 3-1 right now. We got to win tomorrow. Like, that's our mindset, and that's pretty much how we've done all playoffs in these elimination games.
And unnecessarily fouls him, and good crossover.
On Friday night during Game 4, Nikola Jokic faced foul trouble, and Jamal Murray had a poor shooting night. But it was Aaron Gordon leading the Nuggets in scoring with 27 points, while Bruce Brown scored 21 off the bench. The Miami Heat turned the ball over 14 times and made 8 out of 25 three-pointers. As Miami got to within 5 points early in the fourth quarter, the Nuggets exploded with a few minutes left in the game and pulled away. Spoelstra says the team is now focused on Game 5.
By the time we got on the flight, everybody was great. We get to compete in this kind of game, you know, tomorrow night. Everybody's looking forward to that. If you're a real competitor, that you want this. You want the feeling that you have, you know, today, tomorrow, leading up to the game, how you feel, you know, in your heart and your stomach when that ball gets tipped up. We've had setbacks. That's part of the playoffs. Tough losses. Our group has shown a resilience to bounce back and show that defiance time and time again.
This is the fourth straight home loss for Miami, while Denver has won 5 straight on the road. The only team to rally back from a 3-1 finals deficit were the 2016 Cleveland Cavaliers, led by LeBron James.
Love playing in these kind of environments, you know, where it's the crowd's going to be great, you know, tomorrow. Everybody's counting us out. We're used to that. But ultimately, it has to be decided between those four lines. The crowd's not going to decide it. The narratives aren't going to decide it. Whatever the analytics are about 3-1, that ain't going to decide it. It's going to be decided between those four lines, whose game can get to whose game and ultimately win at the end. That's what our guys love. That's what we're looking forward to it.
Game 5 will take place in Denver on Monday night. And if the Heat manages to extend the series, Game 6 is scheduled for Thursday. Steve Angels, ABS-CBN News.
K-pop boy group EXO announced Sunday it will make its highly anticipated comeback next month by releasing a full-length album. On its social media pages, EXO began teasing its 7th studio album titled Exist, which will be available to the public on July 10. It is the boy band's first release in over 2 years. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com.